we've got to give more schools more local control, more flexibility. The State Board of Education can provide a large number of waivers to that burdensome Ed Code, and it's the state superintendent's responsibility and priority to push those waivers forward. So I believe working with county superintendents and with district superintendents, we can move forward and get a lot more flexibility to our local schools right away so that kids, so that teachers and principals and parents are making those key decisions in their local communities. The state superintendent can be the one, and should be the one, leading on the policy with the legislature rather than reacting to the legislature. Working with parents, working with superintendents and teachers to say what policy makes the most sense for our schools rather than right now playing defense and letting politicians and political dynamics drive what's happening policy-wise.
Thank you. Mr. Torlakson.
Well, I'm a teacher and I'm a superintendent. My goal when I wake up every day is to improve the schools of California for the benefit of all of the students in the great state of California. And I have a track record of performance with business building, bringing people together, building teams. Right now we have a great team. The governor prioritizes education, State Board of Education prioritizes education, I prioritize education, and guess what? We're working together and the results are better than ever before. Our parent involvement is historic in the level of parent engagement involved, and more needs to be done, no doubt about it. We have a lot of work to do, but we're heading in the right direction. Reform on 21st century skills, career education, bringing technology into our schools. These are things where we work as a team. The legislature, I led the effort to get $1.25 million to invest in bandwidth and computers and the professional development so our teachers can teach the new 21st century skills. That's just one example. $500 million I was able to obtain for career pathways involving students with real world experience, businesses, partners, mentors, providing internships and exciting learning opportunities.
Thank you. Next question. Enrollment in teacher preparation programs at its lowest level in years. These programs are not drawing the best and the brightest. Yet many of the policy signals of potential teachers are likely to be perceived as negative. Pensions have been reduced. Numerous proposals have been floated to base personnel decisions and compensation on test scores. The courts are looking at making it easier to fire teachers and to extend the length of their probationary employment period. Are these policies negative signals to prospective teachers? Why or why not?
Well, this is indeed a challenge because it's dropped off from maybe 50,000 teacher candidates a year down to about 25,000. And this is a tragedy. And it's partly due to the chaos of the 5 years of the recession, but we need a more welcoming environment. We need a more encouraging environment. So we do need to recruit and train the best and the brightest. We need to give them a world-class training program, give them hands-on experience, real classroom experience, as they get ready to go on with their probationary period as teachers. We need to support teachers through the arc of their career. I have supported legislation that will provide low interest loans to have those students come and be part of our education team, help teach in the harder to teach areas, higher risk areas, for students that need additional help. So we have a comprehensive plan to encourage more students to become those teachers. There's a plan called a cadet program like we have for firefighters and police for teacher cadets. I would like to implement that in California and have more of our young people see their future as coming back to their neighborhood and being the outstanding, inspiring teacher those students need in those neighborhoods across the state.
Thank you. Mr. Duncan.
As somebody who's been running schools for the last 12 years in some of our toughest neighborhoods, there's just no question the most important thing a school can do is have a loving, caring, excited teacher in front of those kids. And I've seen teachers like Trevor Jaquez and Will Heiser who literally have been teaching kids for years, and they have dozens of students who will say, those teachers changed my life. So there's nothing more important in our school system than attracting, exciting, and keeping high-quality people to come into teaching. And we're just not doing that right now as a state. And our state's not leading on this. We have a lot of big things to take on. We have to find a way to think about teacher compensation differently and more. Because right now as a teacher, you can't teach in LA and live in LA, and that is a real problem. You look at the policies. I think right now policies like seniority-based layoffs actually are a disincentive for people to want to go into teaching. Because who wants to take a job where you can do great at your job and get laid off 5 years later, irrespective of your actual performance? And I believe the state superintendent, every member of this legislature, and the governor need to be on a regular basis on college campuses, talking to kids, getting them excited to come into what is one of the people profession you can find out there.
Thank you. We have a related question as a follow-up. How should the state go about recruiting and retaining talented professionals to staff our classrooms?
I think I mentioned a couple of them. I think if you look, you know, I believe that the most important, you know, form of service to country is military, but right behind it is teaching.
And I think we should have every single politician and every single leader out there on a regular basis talking on college campuses, talking to them about how to get them excited to come into this profession. We have to get serious at the state level in our budget so we can provide more dollars for teacher compensation. That doesn't, that means we get serious about maybe decreasing dollars for things like increasing or overspending as a state. And I think we have to change the ed code and the policies. Right now, you're so constrained as a teacher by Sacramento telling you what to do and how to do it through our ed code that who wants to go to a job where you're not able to truly be creative and exciting? And that those are the kind of things that don't attract our young people to come in. And in terms of retention, we need high quality work conditions for teachers, which means let's give them more time for collaboration. Teachers need time to work with each other to get better. They'll feel good about their job. When they feel good about their job, they are supporting and educating kids and kids soar.
Thank you. Mr. Corbett.
Well, investing in education has to be our top priority, and it has been my priority. We've seen a major turnaround. We're seeing programs being rebuilt again, career education expanded, science education expanded. And we find out as we survey teachers that they want the resources, they want the tools to be the teachers they know they can be, to inspire the children in their classrooms. So this is a key part of where we're going, to invest in and take a stand and go out and get the resources. And I've done this, and turned things around in districts across the state of California.
Thank you. We're now ready to move on to round two, in which questions will be asked by a panel of representatives of the hosting and co-sponsoring organization. And each candidate will have 1 minute to respond to the question. And we'll start with Arturo Delgado, Superintendent of Schools, representing the LA County Office of Education.
In California, a group of 10 school districts formed their own coalition called CORE to apply for recent top funds, separate from that of the state of California. Is this an alternative that should be pursued by other districts? Why or why not?
And we'll start with Mr. Clements.
I think that's a decision, in the end, that must be made locally by the elected school board and by the parents and leaders of that community. I supported, even though some were opposed to having the CORE formed, I supported it because I thought it would be better for students. The superintendents of those districts and school boards felt that a new organization that they put together could improve the outcomes for students. I was for that, but I think it has to be entered very carefully, and then I think teachers, as part of the team, need to be brought into the decision making about how the partnership would work, how their role would be emphasized and identified.
Thank you. Mr. Clark.
As I mentioned earlier, the more flexibility we can give to teachers and principals and parents locally, the better off for kids. And our state is one of a very few number of states in the country that did not get flexibility from No Child Left Behind from the federal government. Flexibility that we know superintendents want, that we know educators want, that's helpful to our kids. It's more flexibility to use money on programs that make sense for kids, more flexibility from the rules. And we chose, the current state superintendent and the state chose not to apply for those waivers. And because of that, school districts on their own might apply for that. So as state superintendent, one of the first things I will do is move forward and work with all of the districts and say, let's actually get waiver from No Child Left Behind for all of the state, not just for 7 school districts. Right now, and I think this is again a situation where we could get more flexibility from the federal government. We could actually give school districts locally more control, but we are choosing not to as a state, and that's a decision to be made by the state superintendent and by the Sacramento establishment. It's not for kids.
Thank you. Now we have a question from Linda Law, representing the Los Angeles County School Trustee.
Thank you. For many students, student success will require a seamless transition between various educational agencies to smoothly transition students from high school to college. What is your vision for creating that seamless transition, and what are the obstacles that need to be removed?
We'll start with Mr. Duck. 1 minute.
The work we did in a bunch of schools, and both at Green Dot, where I've led a number of high schools and middle schools, elementary schools, we did a couple things. So one is we invested heavily at the high school level in terms of additional counseling support and additional support to think about more time for that transition to go into the university. We were very close to the university partners in order to ensure that our students actually were prepared, one, had access to those universities, and two, actually were prepared. Three, we led to a lot of community organizations. Just saw a lot of success from community groups that had pathways to college, pathways to career programs, which you brought on the campuses, like Santee High School, and like Mendez Learning Center, that was just instrumental for our kids. And the end result was, we increased our graduation rates by 60%. We dramatically increased the number of young people actually going to college. And in bringing these practices at scale across the state, we're identifying what's working really well in schools like ours and making sure other districts are doing that, helpful to facilitate university and K-12 interaction. To me, is something that I've just seen to succeed in other kids.
Thank you. Mr. Gorgens.
Well, it certainly does need to be connected and worked out at a more focused level. And pleased to say that $250 million was given to me and my department to set up a system of grants to encourage just that. We just kicked off High Tech LA, fantastic program where hundreds of businesses are involved, and we're getting coursework from high school to community college onto the university. Another example of this kind of approach, we branch out across the state to encourage. Hartnell Community College works with the high schools in Monterey County on an engineering or computer science and coding. And those students start as freshmen with an articulated set of coursework. They go through, they graduate. They will enroll in the community college, so when they graduate with a high school diploma, they have an AA in computer sciences, and then they go on, and they can finish and get a BS degree in 3 years, or 3.5 years, not 4 years, or 5 years. And that's an example of very true articulation. Another case is a Missouri college, another case for Wake. Thank you.
Thank you for respecting our time limits. Now we'll hear from Marilyn Mushy, representing the League of Women Voters of California Education.
Education reform has long been a major point of discussion and debate, yet there is no real agreement on what the most needed and effective reforms are or should be. Over the past couple of years, California schools have experienced major changes with the adoption of the local control funding formula and new accountability requirements, beginning implementation of the Common Core state standards, a new testing system, expansion of charter schools, and a recent court ruling on teacher tenure and related matters. The question, is it fair to say that we have before us this evening a choice between two change agents with different ideas of what changes need to be made? Yes or no, why or why not? Please elaborate.
Wow.
And we'll start with Mr. Cortez.
So the question again is, you can just a bit longer.
No, I knew this was going to be a hard one. It's so long. The question is, it fair to say that we have before us
a choice between
two change agents with different ideas and what changes?
Well, we are in the midst of historic positive transformation of the education system. Truly, this is historic in its magnitude. And I am a reformer in saying, let's make sure we can seize these opportunities as we possibly coordinate to help the state and state superintendent facilitate that change. There are some things where we would agree, my opponent and I, and some things where we disagree. For instance, on the issue of the length of time before teacher becomes permanent in their status. But I believe we have dynamic time going forward. I'm excited about the change and meeting that change. And the accountability that's coming with it is new and refreshing. And parents, working with school board members, with business leaders, it's a new day in California education. And I'm proud of the work we're doing together, collaboration at all levels, to make this happen for our students, for their success.
Thank you. Mr. Tuck.
There's no question that we need fundamental change in our schools. There's no question that I'm a change agent. I mean, look at the work that I've done the last 12 years in LA and beyond. It's about how do we truly transform our schools so every child has a quality education. I don't think the state, in terms of how the state operates and the status quo is changing. I think the Vergara lawsuit is the clearest example of that, where right away, after a judge literally said the evidence shocks the conscience in this lawsuit, the entire Sacramento education establishment said, we're against it, we appeal the case. The state superintendent appealed, and almost every single member of the state legislature and state establishment has either been quiet or is fighting against it. So that tells you that still is business as usual in our state, that we are not making the fundamental changes, that we are not changing first and foremost the most important question, which is every single decision based on kids. Not based on insiders, not based on interests, based on kids. And that's what has to change. That hasn't changed. That's what has been stuck 45 today, 44, 20 years ago. We need fundamental change now, and that's what this campaign is all about.
Thank you. And now, Kathy Moffitt, California State Fair.
As you know, PTA is all about parent involvement. Recognizing that parent involvement is a key factor in student success. The state of California has made parent involvement one of the 8 priorities required of local districts as part of their local control and accountability plan process. What can you do as state superintendent to support school districts in their efforts to effectively engage their many parent community?
Mr. Tucker.
I think parent involvement starts with, are we really giving parents power and rights to be true partners and true advocates in our schools? And there is a Parent Empowerment Act, which gives parents a true ability to turn schools over when they are failing. I've been a strong supporter out of the gate. It's a bill that the current state superintendent actually voted against when he was in the legislature. And I think it's clear to show, I believe, real parent power. Secondly, if you look at my work, we took over the lowest performing schools in LA. The first thing we did was we created a school report to give parents the information that they needed to see how does a school actually do. Simple, user-friendly, accessible to parents. So we put the power in the hands of parents. And then lastly, we invested to engage parents. We launched a parent college on Saturdays in Watts, in East LA, Saturdays, 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. Parents come to school to learn how to be partners in this work. And the state superintendent's job is, let's find the schools that are doing great work on parent engagement, and let's share those practices and make sure every single school is prioritizing parents, and let's make policy that gives parents real power to be partners in this work.
Thank you. Mr. Cordes.
Well, I was pleased recently the State Board of Education to have about 150 school administrators, school board members, and community advocates come and say that we were on the right path in getting parents engaged. And we need to do more of it, of course. I have proposed getting the best practices. We worked with PK, PICO, Urban League, Los Angeles. We worked with Californians together. We worked with PTA. And there were genuine and very effective outreach efforts made. And also understand the differences of our parents. Some parents are getting up early to catch a bus at 5 or 5:30 in the morning. They don't get back in time to go to an evening meeting during the week. And so providing Saturday schools, providing interpreters at meetings for non-English speaking parents, providing daycare or childcare for those parents so they can come and really be part of the discussion in a genuine way. There were a few districts that had token approaches and didn't genuinely involve their parents. We want to show those districts there's a better way, a right way. And again, the new state law, local control, really says, underscore the involvement and participation of parents. It's better for kids.
Thank you. Now ready for our second round of panelist questions, starting with Bill Gunn.
We've heard a lot tonight, and a great deal about local control, change agents, and parent power, and the like. However, the greatest changes that we've seen locally in our school districts have, such as Common Core, and the LCFF, LCAP, seem to all be coming from Sacramento. And so the question is, how do you propose to balance the intent of local control with decisions that have to be made or should be made by those administering the changes in the local districts, superintendents, boards of education, parent associations? How do you propose to balance that with the decisions being made in the state?
Start with Mr. Cordes.
Well, again, I think the major decisions at the store, I think trend setting nationwide in terms of what we've done in California, point in that direction of really moving power to the local level. I'll give you one example. My opponent talks about the education code. We have taken a direct look at the education code and said, let's eliminate some of the red tape. We have 39 separate programs tied up $13 million in spending in the ed code. We cut the red tape and allowed local districts to make the decisions on how you would prioritize and spend your share of the $39 million. And so, again, this is a lot of communication needed, but power shifting to the local school boards. I see this as a very, very positive trend. The collaborative I mentioned, the legislature put out $10 million at our request, my request, for creating a collaborative between school administrators, teachers,
frontline school board members to talk about how we can help each other. Best practices that we have in one jurisdiction can be moved over to another school district. Let's work together.
Thank you. Mr. Tucker.
I think it really comes down to we have to really change business as usual in Sacramento, because there is a natural tendency to try to keep control and tell local school districts what to do and how to do it. And when I think about local control, I think about more local control over funding, over staffing, over curriculum, over your school structure and your school day and time. You know, thinking about how do we actually give traditional public schools more local control than by definition charter schools that you have today in schools. That's local control. And let's take a specific example. We hear a lot of local control recently. And then a couple weeks ago, legislation gets moved forward that's going to cap the amount of money that a school district can put on reserve. The state is telling superintendents and school communities how much money they can hold on reserve. Even though we know during the recession, the school districts that did the best job during the recession were the ones that actually had higher reserves because they were able to keep their teachers and not have to make any layoffs. And then Sacramento comes right in after making a lot of discussion around local control and right away takes that control away from the school district. So to me, it's not just about talking, it's taking real action.
Thank you. And now a question from Ms. Warren.
The purpose of charter schools was to provide schools that were innovative or different from other public schools in some way. Today, some communities have voiced concern that California spends a significant amount of public funds on charter schools, yet there is little empirical evidence that charter schools produce better results than other public schools. How should California handle charter schools in the future to ensure that they actually are models of innovation or provide something different than the other public schools?
Start with Mr. Tuck.
Now, I have a unique experience here because I was the president of Greendale Public Schools, which was a number of charter schools, and I actually led the partnership for LA Schools, which is traditional public schools. So I've operated both in a charter school environment and a traditional public school environment. And there's no question I believe that charter schools have been beneficial to kids and parents, because for the first time it really gave parents who had the least real choice and opportunity to make decisions for their kids in their schools. I also believe that you'll see some just incredibly innovative school models because they have a lot more flexibility on the education code than traditional public schools. And I believe that we have to give that same flexibility to teachers and principals in our traditional public schools. I do think that we have to do a couple things better with charter schools. If charter schools aren't performing well, they do need to shut down, because the whole point was more flexibility or more accountability. We have to invest a lot more in having real, true, genuine collaboration between traditional public schools and charter schools, so when there are really fun, exciting, enriching practices that are helping kids, that those are being learned from charter school to traditional district, and also from traditional district to charter school. So I'm a supporter. There's certainly some things we've got to work on to make sure we're focusing on kids and provide the best school for all kids.
Thank you. Mr. Torlakson.
Charter schools are a part of our education system. There are good charter schools, there are excellent charter schools, and there are those that aren't living up to their promises to the parents and to the students that they enrolled in those schools. Those charter schools that are subpar and aren't performing, they should be shut down, as my opponent just said. We also need to look at how those schools may have innovated and found some good practices. There are different varieties of charter schools.